Hey again, it's Jason from Fraser Valley Rose Farm, and today I want to talk to you about whether it's safe to use rooting hormone in your garden for yourself, for your plants, for the environment. What's the safety factor of rooting hormone? And the most common form of rooting hormone that we use is a chemical called Indole-3-butyric Acid. It's usually in a product like this, which is a rooting powder that you would dip the bottom of your cuttings in to get them to root faster. So I've broken this video into a few different sections assessing its safety in different ways. I'll put that index up on the screen right now. The first safety issue I'm going to deal with is whether this IBA that's in these products is acutely toxic, or I guess the question is, are you going to poison yourself by handling it or ingesting it or getting some on your hands? And the answer to that fairly quickly is no, and the reason for that is fairly interesting. IBA is naturally occurring in a lot of plants. It's in willow, it's in corn that you eat all the time. It's just related to the auxins that tell your plants how to grow and what to do, which is why it has an effect on the rooting of the plants. Now, the auxin, the IBA that's used in these products, is synthetically produced, but there's no evidence that the synthetically produced IBA is any different in terms of its effects on your body than the naturally produced IBA. So this is not something your body is completely foreign to, and currently, in small amounts, it is able to quickly convert that to other non-harmful chemicals in your body, and it's no problem. Its acute toxicity is similar to caffeine. So if you take anything, even if it's natural, in a high enough dose, and you can cause problems for your body. But unlike caffeine, you're not purposely introducing this into your body. And just to give you some additional context on this, the amount of rooting powder that you would have to ingest for you to have a toxic reaction is in the measure of pounds. So unless you're taking up a snorting habit of rooting powder, you're unlikely to get any toxic reaction to rooting powder or gel. Now, if it's more concentrated, you want to take more precautions with it. One more thing I'll mention is that the active ingredient being IBA, the inactive ingredient, at least in the rooting powder, is talc. And that's actually where most of the handling concerns come in, because talc is like a fine powder. You could get that in your eyes and that could cause irritation. You could breathe some of that in and again cause some lung irritation. The directions on the MSDS say that if you get it on your hands, wash it off with soap and water. If you get it in your eye, rinse it out. And if you get it in your lungs, go get some fresh air. The second safety concern I'm going to deal with is whether it's safe to eat food from plants that are grown with rooting hormone, because that's been brought up to me before, and I wanted to address it here, is that the EPA did an assessment on IBA, and it found that it posed no health risks to humans or the environment. And I'll put that quote up from the EPA right now. And of course, this depends on how much you trust scientists, or at least these scientists, but that gives you some indication of the work that's been done on it. Like I said before, IBA is naturally present in a lot of foods and naturally present in the environment. So that should give you some clue that there's some capacity in your body to deal with this. But I still wanted to deal with the question of, could the application of rooting hormone to the roots translocate in the plant and move from the roots up to the fruit or whatever part of the plant that you're going to be eating? Now, this is kind of a red herring argument in a way, because we actually don't produce a lot of food crops from cuttings. But let's say you don't have to do it something like gooseberries or plum trees or something like that, and you use rooting hormone. I did find a study that talked about rootstock on plums, and they stuck it with IBA and then tested the tissue at the bottom of the cuttings to figure out how much IBA actually got absorbed into those tissues and then how long it persisted. And what they found is that it only was absorbed into the plant in parts that could be measured in millionths of grams, and that most often it degraded over the course of 2 weeks and at most up to about 6 weeks. So there's very little chance at those quantities and at that level of persistence that the IBA would accumulate to any degree upwards in the plant. The third safety issue I'm going to talk about is whether it's safe and effective to use this on your plants. And I guess the safety question would be, is it going to harm my plants? Is it phytotoxic? The answer there depends on the rate. So for plants that are easy to root, things that are cut in softwood, rapidly growing plants, you may not have to use rooting hormone at all. It may not benefit you a lot. So in that case, just take your cuttings, stick them clean, don't worry about it. If you do find that they're a little bit inconsistent in rooting, or you have a variety that you're having some troubles with, you can apply it at its lowest rate for those fast rooting plants. So for a softwood cutting, you might apply it at the rate of 0.1%, which is 1/10 of 1%. And in that case, it may speed along or make your results a little more consistent. Moving on to semi-hardwood cuttings, that's what I take most of my cuttings as. Semi-hardwood cuttings of moderately easy to root plants is usually around the rate of 0.3%. And this is the first place I'm going to warn you is don't over-apply. Don't use a powder that's rated at 0.8% or 1.6% or some higher rate, thinking that's going to speed things along. In that case, it usually will reduce your rate of success in cuttings. It's still not toxic for you to handle, but it's going to reduce the success rate for your plants. So don't over-apply. I'm going to show you now the way that I stick it on semi-hardwood cuttings and what that looks like. Over here on the left, that's from a horticulture store where I got IBA at 0.4% for my semi-hardwood cuttings. And I use that a lot, but I don't use it directly out of this canister here. I pour it off into smaller containers. That way I don't contaminate what's in the main container, because there's a lot more in there, probably a couple years supply. And just incidentally, if you keep it in a cool, dry place, I think a couple years is fine. Go anything past that, you probably want to get a fresh supply. So here's a cutting I took from outside. It's not exactly the right time of year for it, but for this demonstration, it won't matter, because dipping it into powder, first of all, I was asked the question recently, should I dip it in water first and wet it and put it into the powder? And the answer is no. But if you do that, what you'll end up with, just going to use this as a demonstration, is a bit of a heavy paste on the end of your cutting. And you see how much is sitting on there. And that's far too much rooting powder to sit on there routinely. So you don't dip it first in water. You do a dry dip like this, and then tap it off so you don't have a whole ton of powder sitting on there. That's just a light coating of powder on the bottom of that stem, and that's it. So now I say I have the powder here, I've put it into a smaller container there, you dip, you tap, but if you're not using that, you can use gels, or you can use, like this one here, is a liquid, and you just follow the instructions and dilute that liquid into water like this, and then in that case, pretending this is a clean cutting, you just do a dip like this for 1, 2, 3, maybe even up to 5 seconds, and then pull it out, and your job is done. And that's already got what it needs. For hardwood cuttings and harder to root plants, you may have to use a higher rate and just follow the recommendations and guidelines provided by scientists and the manufacturers to figure out exactly what rate you need, because really, over-applying is not good. It's usually better to start at a lower rate, something like 0.3% or 0.8%, and then only move up from there if you're not getting the success that you need. Finally, I want to have a quick discussion about the use of IBA and its sustainability aspect, whether it's environmentally responsible or responsible for my business to use IBA for making my cuttings. And I know when talking to gardeners that a lot of them expressed to me a real hesitancy to using chemicals, a much higher preference for using natural alternatives, and I completely sympathize with that. It's the reason why on my own farm I've sworn off the use of heavy pesticides in my plant production, because I just don't like the risks to myself, I don't like the risks to my environment, and my family, frankly, for being around it, so I don't want to use that on my farm. When it came to IBA, the assessment came down to, when I looked at the risks, when I assessed those realistically, I don't think there's much of a chance that I'm going to poison myself with this. I don't think that the long-term exposure, at least as far as the evidence shows, has much of a risk. And that if you use it as directed and don't dump it into a stream, you won't have any significant impacts on the environment. So overall, I'm quite happy or satisfied to make that a part of my business. That said, if you're into the natural alternatives, I won't argue that one little bit. I will say I did a quick trial on honey. I can link that video up above here, and I found the results to be unimpressive. I think your better prospect would be willow water. And when I looked up the scientific research on using extracts of willow or willow water on rooting things, I found that there were some really promising results, but some very inconsistent results as well. And so I think some work would have to be done on standardizing how you extract it, what dose you use, so that you can get really good, consistent results for yourself. For me, I'm not looking for another hobby trying to figure that out, so I'm probably going to stick with the rooting powder. And I will say, to make a final argument here, yes, you could do without rooting powder. Yes, you could go to natural alternatives, which may or may not be quite as effective. But when it comes to IBA, I get a good, consistent result, which means that I'm actually using fewer resources growing my plants. So if I'm using a heated bench and I put plants on there and they root faster because I use rooting hormone, I'm using less energy. I'm also using less bench space, which costs me money, less water for my misting system. I'm using less of my own personal time, all of which are factors in the sustainability of my small farm business. So the sustainable option in my case may be using IBA rather than avoiding it. All right, thanks so much for watching today on the safety issues around IBA and rooting hormones. And if you have any questions, comments, concerns, please leave those below the video. I'd be happy to hear them and discuss them with you.